This is a legitimate question because we're building a search engine and a browser, and lots of people have this idea that the problem is actually solved and Google has won, right? That basically there is a good search engine called Google, there's a good browser called Chrome, there's a good operating system called Android that has Chrome in it, and then Google search, problem solved. How can you even think that you could change that, right? The lines are going all in one direction. It's, you know, game over basically, right? And what I want to show you is that, and that's the same for mobile, basically 10 years ago, the picture inverted, right? The small guys became big and the big guys became small. If you look at it historically, and I'm looking just at the browser thing, there was a browser that had 90% market share called Netscape about 20 years ago. It got beaten up by Explorer when Microsoft realized that the browser was a very, very, very critical strategical point because it could replace the operating system, essentially, and decided to put all his weight, and Microsoft was the Google of the 90s, basically, so they put all his weight behind Internet Explorer and quickly beat up Netscape to oblivion. They became so powerful that they again reached 90% market share. And out of the ashes of Netscape came out basically Firefox, which was the open source version of Netscape. And in 2010, the chart ends up at 2010, they ended up having 50% market share in Germany. And so much so that a couple of years later, they basically said the war for browser is over and Firefox has won. And so you can see that there has been already at least three of these humps going to 90% and then back down to zero. So to say that the history is over is a little bit premature. In any case, one thing happened here when you were looking at this is that both of these competitors were non-profit. Microsoft was a non-profit business in that particular case because they had been told by the FTC, the antitrust in the US, I forgot what they called, and the antitrust in Europe, that they could never, ever, ever make money with Explorer because they were abusing their power to do so. And they got a very strong ruling. So Microsoft, for many years, was routinely hit on the head with $700 million fines from the EU, which essentially forced them to do nothing with Explorer for about 10 years. Firefox was a non-profit because they came out of this guy, and they were afraid to make profit because they were afraid to be bought back by AOL if they were making profit. And so essentially we had a non-business running one of the most critical piece of technology in the world. But there was a business emerging, even though no one really saw it. It was the business of search. And no one really saw it. This is the New York Times in 2002 saying, well, Google will never have a business model. Forget it, they're doomed. Right? So the business at that time was advertising, and if you wanted to do advertising, you needed to have a portal, and if you wanted to make a lot of money, you have to retain user as long as possible. And Google was sending user as fast as possible out of their websites, out of their search engine. And so it was considered to be unlikely that Google will ever build a business model. This is only 15 years ago. This is not so long. And Google started to realize that browsers were enormously critical to search because really what do you do? What do you search? You search web pages. How do you input your search query? You input it in a search page that is rendered by the browser or in the browser itself. And then you get the search result rendered in the browser and then you click on a link and you go into the browser. Why the hell is search different from the browser? It's like separating artificially the steering wheel from the car. And that's why Google started to realize that search was a little bit too critical to not be defended because the search and the browser really determines who the search engine should be, not the other way around. The search engine cannot, it's like the tail wagging the dog. It doesn't really work that way. And Google started to first invest in the browser, obviously, because they wanted to build Chrome, but also to buy every single other browser that they could get their hands on. So Firefox get a few hundred millions a year from Google to be the default search engine to the sadness of Cliqz, even though they're an investor in us. Safari gets, I think, 3 billion or 4 billion a year from Google to be the default search engine. Samsung browser has a default search engine called Google. UC Web in Asia has a default search engine called Google. So Google is essentially spending more and more money defending the browser sphere because it's very, very important. But then again, you've seen this curve go back and forth. So there is not, it would be very strange that history would stop today. And after four major browser cycles, there wouldn't be a fifth. That's just not realistic. Now you would say, but mobile is all different. What is the browser in mobile? I mean, you don't need a browser anymore. It's all about an app world. Well, this is Windows 95 in 95. What is it? It's like you have to download little squares, and then if you want to do anything, you have to press on the right square, and then you can do whatever the square does, but you cannot do something else, of course. And if you want to do something else, you have to go to another square. That's not the future, that's the past. So all mobile operating systems are not necessarily the future. They look a lot like the past. Basically, we have to deal with that the mobile operating system is in fact, and if we look specifically at Android, a better defense mechanism for Google against anyone trying to steal their lunch. This is going to be changed dramatically next week. We'll talk a little bit about this later. So we have to think about disruption. Disruption in essentially three basic ways. We need to disrupt the moat of Google, so we need to make sure that even though they have a great search engine, they should not own the entire world. We need to disrupt the closeness that is emerging in the mobile world. And we need to disrupt the way data is collected from the user. The moat of Google, I think you should really realize that Google has one business that really works called search, and then all the rest is a bit of a defense against everything else. And the defense is the more you look at it, the more it's disturbing to see how much money they are spending to make sure that you always end up in Google. And the fact that this money is increasing speaks against, I mean, the quality of the product is obviously there, but it is interesting that they have to spend so much money to try to make sure that people always end up in Google. Let's talk about openness versus closeness. When the internet came about, digital was not new. This is a Minitel from 1982. Every French family had one. You could do everything you wanted with this thing in terms of digital, and it was free to have it. It was not free to use the services, but it was there. What was new was openness, that you could, without talking to any company, learning just a few very, very simple language called HTML and HTTP, you could create a site that was immediately available to everyone in the world without having to sign a contract, do anything, basically, and not be censored by some kind of review process of an app store or the Minitel, whatever it was. The web was anonymous. There was a joke in 1993 that on the internet, no one knows you're a dog. Today, I would bet that this is not the case. They know you're not a dog, and they probably know what color underwear you wear. And so this has changed dramatically as well. And what beat up all the other systems, so in the US, in France you had Minitel, but in the US you had CompuServe, AOL, Prodigy, all of them were very successful. The web was also ugly. It was ugly in a really good way. HTML was so simple that you could not really not be ugly. But that motivated a lot of people to create websites, because if you don't have the problem of being seen as, oh, I didn't invest $1 million to make myself look beautiful, it's very democratic. And you can see these things in, so on the right side you have AOL. So it was, welcome to 95, do you have a 4.4 baud modem or 28.8 kbit? It was beautiful, white background design, etc. The web was not beautiful. There's a huge advantage to this non-beauty is that many people participate. Right? Today, ask yourself how many hairdressers in the world can really make a mobile app or a mobile website. It has become a lot more difficult. And very successful companies like Tencent in Asia are able to do this democratic design for billions of people because they make it, I call it ugly, but they make it, let's say, reasonably beautiful for the masses. We have to disrupt the privacy stuff. This is what happened when you open one page on Economist. I didn't take a sleazy website. I took one of the best websites in the world. These are all the requests that go out, and you see these little back and forth where all the bit switch and platform 161 exchange data about you. And make no mistake, this is real data. This is not just, and it's got your name on it at the end. It's real data, and they exchange it in the back. This is at least four or five levels away from the original page that you load. The Economist has no idea that this is going on. When GDPR came out, it suddenly became cleaner, not better. It became cleaner. 1 month later, it's back there. The problem is not being fixed, which means that these people believe it's okay to do it again. We need to disrupt this in creating user agents, and the browser is the mother of all user agents, to basically create a layer between the user and the open internet. We need the open internet to be open, but we also need to protect the user, and that's what the user agent is for. But if the user agent is Google, then it has two things that it needs, the search engine result page and building profiles to make money. The story of Cliqz is the same. We started with search, and then we realized we needed a browser, and then we realized that we needed privacy in the browser. And now we are basically building offers because we know we need to be independent of Google. If not, basically everything falls apart. And our business is advertising on the client side. Someone else will talk about this later. And it doesn't conflict with our vision, because if you cannot target the users via targeted advertising, you will be able to give money back to the users, which are our offers or rewards that they are called in grocery. Next week, there will be a big, big decision on Android. The person who is going to communicate it is a Cliqz user, which makes me very hopeful that that she's actually listened to what we said. And Android will be different, because Android is the Windows of today. And maybe we'll have browser choice in Android, and please then make sure you choose Cliqz as a browser and be part of this journey.